Today's topic is wound infection. The effects of bacterial burden, called bioburden, on the wound are numerous and complex. Bacteria not only compete for the limited nutrients and oxygen present in the wound, they produce endotoxins and exotoxins that destroy normal cellular activities such as collagen deposition and cross-linking. All chronic wounds contain some degree of bacterial bioburden and exhibit significantly elevated pro-inflammatory cytokines, matrix metalloproteinases, and neutrophils. These neutrophils release cytotoxic enzymes, free oxygen radicals, and inflammatory mediators, and therefore the wound is not able to advance into the proliferative stage from an inflammatory stage. The most common effect of this persistent chronic inflammatory state is delayed healing. Bacterial bioburden can be subdivided into 5 microbial states: contamination, colonization, critical colonization, biofilm, and infection. Contamination is the presence of non-replicating microorganisms. Local or systemic antibiotics are not required for the contaminated wounds. Colonization does not impair healing, and inappropriate use of antibiotics during this phase has contributed to the prevalence of antibiotic-resistant organisms. Critical colonization criteria can be remembered by mnemonics NERDS, N-E-R-D-S. N for non-healing wound, E for exudative wound, R for red and bleeding wound, D for debris, and S for smell from the wound. Deep tissue infections can be remembered with mnemonic STONIES: size is bigger, temperature increase, probes to or exposed bone, new area of breakdown, erythema, edema, exudate, and smell. Almost 70% of chronic wounds have a biofilm present. The biofilm comprises various types of organisms living together in symbiotic relationships in a harmonious community. Proteus and staph are the most common of microorganisms forming a chronic biofilm. Treatment of biofilm is debridement and followed by moisture retentive dressings. Continued weekly maintenance treatment keep wound biofilm in a weakened and a susceptible state of infection. Wound infection occurs when microorganisms on the wound surface penetrate into the wound tissues. A local or systemic response is indicative of an infection. Clinical indications for wound infection are lack of healing after 2 weeks of topical therapy, local signs of infection like increased erythema, increased amounts and or change in the character of exudate, odor, increased local warmth, edema or induration, pain or tenderness, systemic signs of infection like fever, chills, high white count or leukocytosis, elevated glucose in patients with diabetes, and pain in neuropathic extremity. Greater than 90% of chronic wounds have polymicrobial flora, containing up to 4 species depending upon the type of wound. Clinical manifestations and diagnosis of wound infection are based primarily on the clinical assessment and culture. The classic local signs of infection may be absent in case of malnutrition, steroid therapy, immunosuppression, and wound chronicity. The risk factors for wound infection can be elicited through history of prior wounds, family history of chronic wounds, systemic conditions like HIV or rheumatoid disease, malnutrition accompanied by weight loss or obesity, diabetes, immunodeficiency, hypoxic conditions like COPD, or any near ischemic disease like peripheral arterial disease, heart failure, shock, or dehydration, organ failure, heart failure, kidney failure, liver failure. Remote infections also affect. social habits like drug use or abuse, smoking, and drugs that impair healing like corticosteroids, anti-inflammatory drugs, and chemotherapeutic agents. Three techniques can be used to obtain wound cultures: biopsy, needle aspiration, and swab culture. Tissue biopsy is when the biopsy specimen is taken from clean tissue with a scalpel. The tissue biopsy is considered the gold standard for wound culture. Needle aspiration is to aspirate tissue, fluid, or pus, and swab technique is the most commonly performed method to obtain cultures. The goal of treatment of wound infection is for critical colonization and infection. It is to reduce the bioburden without causing tissue injury or the development of drug resistance. Early control of bioburden with topical antimicrobials has the potential to reduce the need for antibiotics and prevent the development of resistant strains. When the patient has an intact immune system and the subtle signs of critical colonization are still present, but no local or systemic signs of infection are seen, intervention should be modified to 1. Assess adequate relief from the underlying etiology. 2. Ensure adequate resolution of cofactors like tissue oxygenation, nutrition, serum glucose levels. And 3. Alter the physiologic wound environment by using a different antiseptic dressing and increasing the frequency of dressing changes. Finally, in summary, create an optimal wound environment requiring diligent management of the wound bioburden. Failure to recognize the manifestation of the continuum of bioburden conditions will lead to prolonged delay of healing and eventually sepsis, as well as the continued growth of antibiotic-resistant microorganisms. The wound care provider must be able to recognize the early and discrete symptoms that are indicative of biofilm formation, critical colonization, and chronic wound infection. Treatment of critical colonization and wound infection requires antibiotics, antiseptic, and debridement.